put your hand out there. Make some noise. Hype it up.
To encourage you, we have some more time left. And how many of you are using your 3x5 cards to continue to pray for those who don't know the Lord Jesus Christ and those who don't have a church home? Praise God. Grateful to the Lord. One of the individuals on my 3x5 card or on my list, praise the Lord, shared with me this week that they had given their life to the Lord. We're grateful to the Lord because, and I share that because it's a reminder that God answers prayer. God answers prayer. And I definitely believe that God is concerned about souls. And it is our desire to make our business God's business. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. So we're grateful to God. And back again, as many of you know, we have been sharing along the lines of church growth, and we want to continue to do that. Hopefully many of you have gone out and gotten the book. Yes. Or if you didn't, I'm going to encourage you to do it. Amen. It's a good book. Amen. I am a church member, praise the Lord, by Tom S. Rainer. I want to bring to your attention this morning a few scriptures, or this afternoon, excuse me, a few scriptures, and we're going to be out of your way. It has been a wonderful day. Sweet, sweet spirit in this place. Amen. On today, I'm grateful to the Lord for everything he's done, everything he continues to pray for those. We're going to take time to thank all of you who are streaming with us on today. We thank God for you taking time out of your busy schedules and to worship with us on today. Praise God. Now, back to business at hand for, excuse me. For those of you who have your Bibles, turn with us. I wanted to show you three scriptures and then I'll get to a sermon for today. As God continues to grow us and develop us, mature us. If you have your Bibles, go with us to the book of John, John chapter 13. John chapter 13. And I just want us to take a look real quickly at a scripture here. It's important that we do this. John chapter 13. Everybody got it? That's prepared to go with Pastor. John chapter 13. Verse 35 reads as follows. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another. Do everybody catch that?
Yes, sir.
Again, John chapter 13, verse 35 says, by this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to, or one for another, depending upon the translation you're reading from. But now, that's important. Amen?
Amen.
So how will people know whether or not you're a disciple of Christ?
Love.
Amen. I want to make sure we know that. Not just say it, but I want to make sure we know it and we live it. Praise the Lord. I'll make another statement in a few moments that I think will connect that. So that's John chapter 13 and verse 35. I want us to take a look at another portion of scripture. Let's look at Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1. And I just want to highlight it in your reading, your hearing. Verses 14 and 15, Ephesians chapter 1, verses 14 and 15 reads as follows, which is the earnest of our inheritance, I probably should read 13 so it makes sense, in whom ye also trusted after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession, until the praise of his glory. Verse 15, wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus, and love unto all the saints. Now I want you to catch that in verse 15. So it wasn't just the faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, or Yeshua the Messiah. It was also the love that was had for the saints. Now that goes a long way, and I'm very grateful today, because one of the things I consistently hear about New Bethel is when people come in, is they say that I can feel the love. We don't want that to ever change.
Amen.
Amen. We want that to always be the case. And I believe that God is love, as the Word of God says. And I think if we get anything else, if we don't get anything else right, let's get love right.
Amen.
Amen. Now, one more scripture for you. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. It reads as follows. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called, with all lowliness and meekness, and with long-suffering, forbearing one another in what?
Love.
There we go. Praise the Lord. In verse 3, I might as well read that. Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. So, what is the Lord looking for from us? He's looking for us to have love. And how many of you know we do this? A lot of times we'll read from Matthew, and we'll talk about how it is God's will that we first love him with all of our heart, soul, and mind, and then also to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. Now, how many of you know that's something that you need to pray on?
Amen.
And when I'm saying that, it's not that you accept it. I want us to pray that God help us to do it.
Amen.
Because it is easy for many of us to say we love the Lord God with all of our heart, soul, and mind. Amen.
Amen.
But the challenge comes when you have to love your neighbor as yourself. And I know it's a struggle when you start asking Jesus questions like, who is my neighbor?
Yeah.
Amen. Pastor's just keeping it real. Praise the Lord. And so we want to continue to do what God has called for us to do. But as I study the scriptures and as we grow, I tell you, and become organized and disorganized, praise the Lord, we find that we need God.
Amen.
Amen. We need God. There isn't much left for us other than to operate by way of faith. So my scripture for today, all of what we're sharing is founded, our foundation is in love. But even as Paul tells us concerning the gifts in the book of Corinthians, if you have all those gifts and whatnot, but you don't have love, it's not worth anything. How many of you know that people, you've met people in your lifetime that have tremendous gifts, or they can be of tremendous blessing, but it's their attitude, it's their spirit, and you don't want to approach them. I deal with this quite often, even at work. People will call me and they'll say, Mike, can I talk to you off the record? Yeah, you know, no problem at all. And many times there's situations and things that they're dealing with where they are forced to deal with people, but their attitudes are so unpleasant. Their attitudes are just nasty or negative. And, you know, you'd rather, have you ever been there where you'd rather go without? Rather than to go,
yes.
I know I'm not the only one, praise the Lord, rather than to bother with sister so-and-so or brother so-and-so. And, you know, I'm sharing it with you because though it is in the house of the Lord, it should not be.
Amen.
And we want to work on things like that. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. But this particular scripture just stuck out to me. It just blessed me tremendously, as all the word of the Lord does. But I want, it's always been interesting to me when I see in scripture how God compares us to animals and certain animals. And it's always of interest to me because I want to know why he does that. You know, I want to see what he sees. Anybody read the word of God like that? You want to know what was on God's mind when he said certain things. Praise the Lord. Because again, I'm convinced that Jesus is going to do this to us. He's going to talk. When we get a chance to meet with him, he's going to say, that's what I said, but that's not what I meant. I'm convinced of that. I'm convinced of that. Praise the Lord. So St. Matthew chapter 25, I want to share a few things from the Word of God today, and we're going to let you go. Amen. It's Youth Day, and I'm trying to break a record. Praise the Lord. Verse 31 says, when the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. And before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd divideth his sheep from the goats. And he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. Then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, come ye blessed of my Father, and inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was an hunger, and ye gave me meat. I was thirsty, and ye gave me drink. I was a stranger, and ye took me in. He says here in verse 36, naked, and ye clothed me. And I was sick, and ye visited me. I was in prison, and ye came unto me. Then shall the righteous answer him, saying, Lord, when saw we thee in hunger, and fed thee, or thirsty, and gave thee drink? When saw we thee a stranger, and took thee in, or naked, and clothed thee? Or when saw we thee sick, or in person, and came unto thee? And the king shall answer and say unto them, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these, my brethren, ye have done it unto me. Verse 41, then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, wow, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was an hungered, and ye gave me no meat. I was thirsty, and ye gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and ye took me not in. Naked, and ye clothed me not. Sick, and in prison, and ye visited me not. Then shall they also answer him, saying, Lord, when saw we thee an hungered, or a thirst, or a stranger, or naked, or sick, or in prison, and did not minister unto thee? Then shall he answer them, saying, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye did it not to one of the least of these, ye did it not to me. And these shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into into life eternal. I want to ask you this morning, are you a sheep or are you a goat? You can only, and only you answer that question. And I want us, as we look at the text today, I won't get through all of it. I'm going to try to go to just 1 o'clock and stop there. And I'll come back, praise the Lord, and just keep ministering as the Lord, the Holy Spirit shall guide us. But I want us to see something right off the back and allow Pastor to go out of order in terms of just notes or just hermeneutics or the flowing of the text, if you will. I want us to stop and I want us to think about this. The Word of God does not contradict itself. Now, I say that because when you read the text, it almost suggests that some of what we do is based upon works. Because you see there, when he starts to talk about the fact that there are those who fed Christ or fed those who were needy and hungered and all that other kind of good stuff, and then there were those who didn't. And at first glance, it looks like that's all that there is to this text, but it's so much more than just that. Because for instance, if we start at verse 1, I want you to understand that no matter what it looks like in the world on today, Jesus Christ is coming back. Yeah. I know we don't hear a lot about messages and sermons like that because, and forgive us, many in the ministry are more concerned about getting rich or how many girlfriends we can have on the side, or, you know, whatever it is, you know, anything that appeals to our flesh, and people are no longer preaching about the fact that Jesus Christ is coming back. Yeah. Now, and that's a good place to celebrate. I'm like, Pastor Henry, I want Jesus to come back. I don't know about you, but I want him to come back. Now, get this, though. I must be selfish just for a moment. I don't want him to come back, and I'm not ready.
Yeah. Amen.
I want him to come back, but I want to make sure that I have prepared myself. Now, get this. I know the word, and I could back up and deal with Matthew 24 as well, too. I think it's important and healthy to also share it from this vantage point, because many times, as my family is going through what it is with mom and dad, my dad has been battling cancer for 7 years. He's doing wonderful, just phenomenal, and I think God is using him to increase all of our faith. Amen. My mother is going through the process, and we're just celebrating Jesus and thanking God for her life. Amen. Praise the Lord. I'm grateful to God. God can do anything. I thank God for all those who have shared material and information, whether it be pills or vitamins or whatever, the herbs is what I mean by pills, herbs or vitamins or whatever, praise the Lord. Some of y'all may come walk away and say, Elder said something he didn't say, praise the Lord. Lady Smith is not on drugs, hallelujah. We're talking about herbs and things that will help her, amen, overcome those challenges, amen. And while I appreciate all of that, I also appreciate the fact that I know Jesus Christ to be a healer.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And my faith in him is such that he will heal both of them.
Yes, he will. Talk about it, Elder. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Say it, Elder.
I wish I had a church that would be able to pass through this morning.
Yes, sir.
Y'all gonna be shocked. I'm gonna sit down. 1 o'clock, praise the Lord. But when I look at what is happening here, it's amazing to me. I want us to remember again that Jesus is coming back. I started deviating for a moment, but he's coming back, Hunter, and I want to be ready when he comes. Now, get this. Here's what I meant to start to say. Even though people think most cases you need to be sick in order to leave here, you don't need to be sick.
Come on, Elder. Amen.
Matter of fact, some of us could be struggling with some stuff we don't even know about in our bodies right now.
Amen.
But here's the thing. Here's the thing that gripped me this week, Sister Sharon. Why? The question was posed to me. Why has Jesus Christ delayed his coming? And I got an answer for that one, but watch this. Why hasn't he come back for you yet?
No.
Not the world. I'm talking about specifically you.
Amen.
And if he does hasten his return, are you going to be ready? Now get this. What's to keep him, Minister Johnson, from coming to get Michael Smith today? Thank you, Mother Bennett. Nothing. So for those of us, today's message, I want you to understand this. Just like in life, I think it is a shame for you to go through life without life insurance.
Amen.
Amen.
And I share that from a very passionate place as a pastor, as a businessman, as a loving father, as a dear friend, because when you die without life insurance, you leave all of that burden on your loved ones. And they gotta scramble and watch this. I would not want First Lady to ever have to make a decision between whether or not they should cremate me. Yeah, so put me in the box. But the fact of the matter is, I ain't gonna know anyway, but it's the principle. But even more than that, can we pause for a moment and really think about if Jesus Christ was to come back today, Brother Alex, would we be ready? We experienced not too long ago a death. A very good friend of mine experienced a death, and I was talking to some other leaders, and it amazed me at how even at death, we're still not able. Now notice I'm talking about leaders. I'm only doing what Jesus would do, because as you read the scriptures, you don't see a whole lot necessarily in terms of the crowd or the people, but you see Jesus nail the leadership. Because they should know better. They're the main ones keeping blocking people from getting all that God wants. And so watch this. I told my wife, I said, it amazes me how leaders don't want to forgive even in death. And leaders don't want to let go even at death. And I thought, what? I just don't understand. And maybe it is I haven't been hurt deep enough. I don't know, but I hope I never get there. But I think God wants us to love people and forgive. That's just Pastor Smith. So get this. He says here, now look at verse 31 again. Not if, and I already told you, I'm not going to deal with all of the text because I'm going to run out of time. But he says, when the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. So God has a set time for when he's going to come back, and I mean, really show everybody who's in charge. Now, until that time, our responsibility, Robert, is to make sure that we get ourselves in order. And when I say that, to make sure that our actions line up with the word of God to the best of our ability.
Amen.
Thank God for grace.
Amen.
This is what also sticks out to me. Verse 32, and before him shall be gathered. Now get this. This is, I love the word. All nations. That lets me know if I'm still standing here and I'm looking at all of y'all, and all y'all kind of, could be my brothers and sisters. This is not it.
Amen.
Oh, thank you, Lord. I'm going to trust you, God, for what you showed me. Praise the Lord. He says, before him, he's going to gather all nations, and he shall separate them. They're going to be people who don't speak English.
Amen.
They're going to be people, I must just go over this just very briefly. They're going to be people, Hunter, that have three and four wives.
Amen.
See, because that's their culture. That's their custom.
I know
those of us on this side of the earth, we want God and Jesus to stop, when he comes back and preach a separate sermon. The fact of the matter is, that's their culture.
Amen.
I didn't say I agree with it, but that's their culture.
Amen.
Any more than certain cultures, it offends them to eat fried chicken, but you eat it.
Amen.
It's funny. I went to, I never forget this, Cameron and Michael school, and they had a gentleman there from Wycliffe, the Bible company, I think it was, and he was a missionary, and they go around and they translate the word of God, but he said something that never left my mind. He said, that scripture where we say, which of us would ask for, this, and, well, God wouldn't give us a serpent, and things of that nature. He says, I actually went to one country, and he said, we had to turn that around because it means the opposite. He said, if you give someone some fish, he said, that's actually offensive to them.
Wow.
I thought, wow, isn't that interesting? And so what it helps me see is that, watch this, there's certain things that we see in the Word of God that really, you got to ask yourself, who are they talking to? Why they make, context makes all the difference in the world. Because if we don't do that from a healthy standpoint, we'll take something and make it a rule that God never meant.
Amen.
But that can only happen, thank you, Jesus, that can only happen when you first conclude that you don't know everything. Let me move on. I don't think y'all enjoy me as much as I'm enjoying myself. All nations, and he shall separate. Now get this. He shall separate them one from another as a shepherd divideth his sheep from the goats. Now, we have got to just digress for a moment and play with that.
Amen.
Notice how he's talking to nations. All nations.
Amen.
Man, I pray. See, he may come to get me before he comes back. But if that happens, I'm covered in Thessalonians because I'm going to come back with him.
Amen.
I don't know about you all, but I just want to see him.
Amen.
And I want to see it take place. Now watch this. When it takes place, Pastor, I don't think I'm going to be one of the ones saying, see, I told you so. That's going to be the farthest thing from my mind. Come on. Is anybody else in here with me that you're going to be so hallelujah glad and thank you, Jesus, happy that you made it? Amen. Look at this. Now get this. He's going to divide the sheep from the goat. Now, Aaron, that catches my attention, because as we will have some fun with the text today, there are a lot of, you know, how many of y'all know church members that act like a lot of different animals?
Yeah.
You, listen, please listen, have some fun today. You don't have to tell anybody who it is you're talking about, but I'm going to ask you one more time. How many of you know we got some church members that act like animals?
Yeah.
You know, my 14 years of pastoring this church, I've seen almost every animal in the zoo manifest himself. Y'all not talking to me. Okay. Some folks are like wolves. I didn't call you. We act like in sheep's clothing, spreading false doctrine. Some folks are like chameleons, changing colors with the crowd. Let me just have some fun with that. And listen, so that you know, I know what I'm talking about. Every now and then I might stop and just expound on it a little bit, but watch this. I know that there are people who talk to you a certain way, but then when they talk to me, it's all nothing but sweet roses.
Amen.
Amen.
I'm just letting you know why Jesus would do this. Many are like bugs who seek darkness because their deeds are evil. Some are like buzzards. You don't see them in church unless a member is dead. Oh, yes. Still others are like snails, no backbone at all. Some are like pigs, greedy to get all for themselves. Others are like roosters, always crowing about something. Some are like goats, always butting the other fellow. Jesus, help me, God. Some are like porcupines, always needing somebody else or needling somebody else. Some are like frogs, leaping from church to church. Some are like gnats, nothing but pests. Some are like geese, fair-weather churchgoers. I know them too. Some are like bumblebees. They'll sting you every time. Wow. Now, this is not our board. But some board members are like lions, always roaring about something. Nobody on our board, though. Some are like donkeys, just plain stubborn.
Amen.
And so we see, if we're not careful, we see it in the church that our characteristics are such that don't necessarily represent Christ. And so watch this. When Jesus comes, he says the very first thing on his assignment. Now get this. This is also what let Pastor Smith know. My responsibility is not to separate the wheat from the tare.
Amen.
Or the sheep from the goat.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Pastor, that ought to be revelation for us, because that's a hard job.
Amen.
When you see stuff come up in the camp and you want to address it and deal with it, but you got to get, watch it now, you got to get a release from God.
Amen.
Because whether you know it or not, the wisdom behind it is those things serve a purpose.
Amen.
There's certain, none of y'all celebrate this, but there's certain goat in here that if they didn't buff, I might not pray that day.
Amen. Amen.
And I could go further. Praise the Lord. We all serve a purpose. And so he's going to separate the sheep from the goats. And it sounds real simple, but watch this. And he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. Now, I must stop and tell you about this. Theologians debate whether or not the text is talking about just the treatment of Jews, or is he talking about just the treatment of the disciples of Christ? Or the last trend of thought is he talking about the treatment of the body of Christ? Now, I'm not the sharpest guy. I'm definitely not the dumbest guy. But I'm convinced, based upon John 3:16, that Jesus Christ died for the
world.
Now, if I was just stuck in the Old Testament, then I would say, maybe just the Jews. But no, I think when, you know, we look at Jesus, and he just told us that he was talking about all nations, I think it's okay to conclude, Dana, he's talking about all of Christianity.
Amen.
Now get this. And let me step outside of that. I really think he's talking about all of creation.
Amen.
Because when or why would it ever be good for you to see someone in need, you have the ability to assist them, and you choose not to assist them? That's really not God's will for any of our lives. I, as I'm praying every day, and I say, God, help me, because I'm a planner. I get up every morning, I have a lot on my mind, business and whatnot, but I say this, God, help me to remain sensitive to you, sensitive enough wherein, when, even though I have my plans, even though I, watch this now, I have my plans, when I sense that you are moving someplace, help me to abort my plans and link up with what you are doing.
Amen.
Because watch this, the more I walk with Jesus, Sister Nicole, I find out how simple. Has anybody, I know the others in here who you're listening, you have a calling on your life, you're walking with God. I know you are dealing with some of the same stuff Pastor Smith is. I am finding out, Deacon Jason, how simple the way of the Lord is.
Amen.
Chuck, I'm finding out that it's not as difficult as I was told it was difficult.
Right.
It's not hard at all. And all you got to do is just want God.
Amen. Amen.
And anytime, watch this, and I know it's just not me, little old me, but I wrote those names on my 3x5 cards, and I just went to praying and believing that God can do it.
Yes.
And God is slowly but surely turning the hearts of people.
Amen.
It's not hard.
Amen.
I know the religious folk will tell you got to, you know, fast for 17 days and 42 hours and then flip, you know, do a cartwheel and up before God even. That's not true. God loves you.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Finding out, it just happened. The latest occurrence, I could tell you more, but I'm running out of time. It happened. I was at work and I was going about my business, doing things, and I pray, God, help me when you're moving. I want to send you, and then I want to abort what I got planned, and I want to link up with you because what He got is greater.
Amen.
And I told my wife, I said, I cashed a check from the church. The church had given to me, and my intentions were to take my family out to eat to a restaurant I happen to like. They don't like it so much, but I like it. I like to. Anybody else there? Praise the Lord. Okay, just me. I like to go places and sit down at a Japanese steakhouse, and I like to see the fire.
Amen.
I like for the chef to almost singe my eyebrows. Not put them up, but just get close enough. I just like that. And cook it right in front of me. I feel special. But my kids sit about 12 feet from the table, and, you know, first lady's chairs behind mine. Nobody appreciates that but me. So I cashed a check with that in mind, Pastor Emery, and the Lord allowed me to cross paths with someone who was really in need. Now, it was very simple, Aaron. There was a time, Dana, where I would struggle to hear God say, give. Oh, come on. You know when you got plans for stuff, God come up and tell you to bless somebody with $1,000, you just, okay, I'm holding on to something right now. I'm waiting, and don't know y'all ask for me, because it's not yours. He didn't tell me. I mean, you pray. I'm waiting right now for Black Friday, because I got things I got to get. Come on. Yes, sir. It's on sale. So I want to get it. I want to hang it in my man cave. Y'all not talking to me long. Come on, y'all. Come on and go with Pastor. I got 6 minutes, watch this, to do this thing. And my point is this. Even though it's nothing wrong with you having a little money or saving up stuff and, you know, wanting nice stuff for your home, watch this. God didn't give us that just for us to feel good. What is probably most important is making sure that, watch this now, because God blesses us and establishes us concerning wealth to establish His kingdom. Uh-oh. See, He doesn't mind me having nice stuff as long as I can always hear Him say, at the appointed time, sell it and be a blessing to the kingdom. Or give it away. So it's not, in this text here in verse 33, it's not so much who, but what. It's just like religious folk, we'll get tripped all up. Well, Lord, how many times should we forgive? Seriously, just forgive. Who are you talking to? Who is my neighbor? Seriously? Anybody got breath in them?
Amen.
I know Jesus must have got tired of answering stuff like that. Seriously. But as we look here, verse 34, then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. God is trying, I got 4 minutes. God is trying to get us, and He's going to eventually take us back to where we were before the fall.
Amen.
You see, in God's mind, watch this now. You see, back in creation, nobody had a need.
Amen.
Preach, elder, Lord.
Amen.
God had given us everything that we needed. He had prepared it all for us. Watch this now. Even before you got here,
amen.
It was already done. Watch this now. It wasn't until Satan came with a little nasty self and brought that spirit of selfishness that need even developed. It was always God's will for us to live by faith.
Amen.
But watch this now. That's why the writer says this. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. That's God's desire for us to never want. But many of us want because, watch this, of the fall of mankind. And unfortunately, the continued perpetuation of sins.
Amen.
When you stop, listen, here's how I know it's still bad. Anytime during this day and time, we have a young man in Alabama who could be murdered and somebody stuff his body inside of some gym stuff and talking about, you know, he climbed up in there and died and suffocated. Are you have lost your mind? And then for the family to have to go through what they're going through to make sure his body's pulled back from the grave, and then they open him up and find out that his organs are missing, he got newspaper stuffed inside of him. So it's sad. Amen. These days. Society is jacked up. And what really would blow my mind is if somebody did all of this because somebody else wanted his organs. Right. Just selfish, just needless murder taking place. Oh, what about this one? The mere fact that the government should be on furlough. Watch this now. And the people who are making decisions, they're busy getting money stuffed in their pockets.
Amen.
How is it, and I love our president, but I don't understand this. How is it that the websites don't work for the people who need it the most? It ain't hurting people like you and I because we have health insurance. But the people we really say we're going to is it me or did anybody else read the scripture thinking it's in Proverbs that says that he that lendeth to the poor, you lend to the Lord.
Amen.
We got to learn to stop. Okay. Help me on this. I got 2 minutes. Lord Jesus, help me. Yes, put this away. Most of y'all know me, know this don't mean nothing because I know more word than what I got time. But I'm going to wrap it up. Praise the Lord. Watch this. Why is it that we're so selfish these days? I'm just at a point in my life where I'm saying, God, help me to stay sensitive to you. Watch this. At what point do you say that enough is enough? And you stop just gleaning and getting, and you want to give. This is what Jesus meant when he said, it's more blessed to.
Amen.
What's my point? My last few moments, I want to come back and deal with this because there's much in this text. God has a system and the enemy has a system.
Amen.
And you know why? Watch this now. If you pull up on the internet pictures of sheep and goat, it's not hard to differentiate between the two. They look different. They can hang with each other for periods of time, but watch this. There's some very distinct differences I want to go over with the church in my remaining minute. You sheep, they eat from the bottom.
Amen.
Goats eat from the top.
Yes.
Sheep have no problem as long as they're in a flock. They're okay being together. Goats have a problem with that.
Amen.
They like to lead themselves. No matter, you can cage it off, and it's only a matter of time they start bucking. It's just their nature. And so watch this, because I don't want you to get confused. When you're looking even at Matthew chapter 7, you see that Jesus says there are people who are going to cast out devils, and they're going to heal, and they're going to help people get delivered. But watch this, his response to them are going to be, depart from me, I never knew you. I don't want you confused today, God. But I want you to understand the scriptures, because the Bible doesn't contradict itself. Watch this now. What God is really getting down to in Matthew 25 is your nature.
Yes.
Watch this, because you can be an unsaved philanthropist.
Amen.
You can do wonderful and good stuff, but still be unsaved.
Amen.
It's getting down to the core. Oh, man, I pray this message has been a blessing to you. To those of you who are watching me and streaming live, come back, and Pastor Smith promises to pick right back up where we left off. The most important thing one today is whether or not you're giving your life to Jesus Christ. You see, here's the beautiful thing. At the end of this sermon, what I must share with the audience, whoever that listening audience is this. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. He is a new creation. That's what it's about. All things, the old stuff is passed away. Behold, look, pay attention to the fact that everything becomes new. What's he talking about? When you give your life to Jesus, you move from being a goat to a sheep. Your nature changes. And so my first call, if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, according to Romans chapter 10, all you have to do is confess that you're a sinner. And then two, confess and accept that Jesus Christ died for you and that he rose again on the third day. And the Bible says, thou shalt be saved. After doing that, I encourage you strongly to find yourself a good church home. Where you'll sit under some good preaching and good teaching and watch God make the difference in your life. Amen?
Amen.
If this message has been a blessing to you, the service has been a blessing to you, we invite you to go to our website, www.nbhop.org. Pray about it. And allow God to enable you to tell you whether or not you should make a donation. It is because of people like you who continue to support this ministry that enable us to be on the air. And so I close today by saying this in my best English. You ain't seen nothing yet. Help me out, congregation. The best is yet to come. God bless you.
Make some noise. Come on, y'all. Make some noise. Make some noise.